Today we're going to talk about heaven because it's the next stop on your agenda. Let me say that to you again. It's the next stop on your agenda. And again, we've preached messages through the years, but we're trying to just show you some little different arenas and little different ways at coming at it, and maybe you'll see and understand and get excited about your next stop. The next train stops at that station, hallelujah, as far as your life is concerned, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, if you don't know him, that is not your stop. It's a stop. Because there are only two places. You either go to be with the Lord, or either you choose, of course, to not be with him. And there's a place called hell that you do not want to have a part of, that was never built for man. Never. And you personally, not family, you personally decide whether you will go to heaven or whether you will go to hell for eternity. And so there is a heaven to gain, as Brother Hagin would say, there is a heaven to gain and there is a hell to shun. So today, as we talk about heaven, we're going to begin with John 14. And heaven is a very real place on God's map. And it's more real than the earth that you are now living in. Earth is fading away. Heaven is on its way. And, you know, the spirit dimension, you and I need to wake up that we are spirit people. And the spirit dimension is very real. And you should not be critical of people who see in the spirit realm. Heaven is becoming so real. Do not let some unbelieving somebody who's caught up in religion talk you out of the reality of the spirit realm. It is more real than where you're sitting in that chair. Heaven is more real than that chair is. Heaven is a real place. Let's go to John 14, verses 2 and 3. This is the New Living Translation. There's more than enough room in my Father's house. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I'm going to come back and get you so that you will always be with me where I am. Now, this is Jesus talking. These are promises of God. You can take this book at what it says to us. I love when it says everything's ready. When everything's ready, I'm going to come get you so that you will always be with me where I am. Now, this is not some generalized something that we're saying. Every person here should take that verse of scripture, and you should be pounding it over and over in your head and should be thinking about it when he says, I'm going to come again. I have personally prepared a place for you personally. Why? Because I know you. I know what you like. I know what you don't like. I know what you want. I know what is pleasing to you. I know you. You know, the Apostle Paul went there, and he talks about it in 2 Corinthians. I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Whether I was in my body or out of my body, I don't know. Only God knows. Yes, only God knows whether I was in my body or outside my body. But I do know that I was caught up to paradise and heard things so astounding that they cannot be expressed in words. Things no human is allowed to tell. And then he talked about it more in 1 Corinthians. That is what the scriptures mean when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. The most anointed sermon in the world still cannot describe, and your mind almost can't handle it. It can, because I've seen some beautiful, beautiful things. And yet, God says they're nothing. Nothing compared to heaven. My word, what we have in store for us. My goodness, you know. It is above and beyond the most beautiful, the most amazing, the most exhilarating, the most active place you could ever imagine. And that doesn't even say enough. We're talking about heaven. So I want to talk about five particular things pertaining to it. Number one, let's talk about who won't be there. Glory to God. Look at your neighbor and say, she's not going to be talking about me. This is a good time to make a proclamation. This is a very good time. You know, words count. Hallelujah. And if nobody's sitting beside you, still put it in their way. You know, so she's not about to talk about. And let's talk about who won't be there. Look at Revelation 21:4. Revelation 21:4. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. Thank God. Hallelujah. You and I cannot even imagine a place. We cannot even imagine a place with no tears, with no death. Never have a reason to cry again. Never feel the slightest pain ever again. Never feel any fear, never feel any kind of anxiety. No hospitals, no cancer, no diabetes, no confusion, no unruly mobs, no violence, no chaos, no negative mindset, thank God. None of these, all of those are effects of sin. Sometimes we forget that, so I want to make sure you really heard that. Everything I just named was an effect of sin. You'll be happy that you learned the truth somewhere. And you'll be so glad that it wasn't, you know, watered down in some breezy, stupid sounding something that they're teaching here, there, and yon, and everywhere. When you get there, you will be saying, thank God I paid attention to the truth. And you'll be saying, thank God, somewhere along the line, be it mama, be it grandmama, be it whomever, daddy, be Sunday school teacher, preacher, whomever it was, thank God somebody told me the truth. You know, if you've never done that, it really would be, I believe it would make the heart of God happy for you to whisper that sometimes. Thank God somebody got to me. Thank God you sent somebody, because you listen, if the Holy Spirit does not stir you, if the Holy Spirit does not woo you on your own, you can't mash a button and say, I think today's the day I'm going to do it. The Holy Spirit has to woo you. The Holy Spirit has to tug on your heart. And if the Holy Spirit is not tugging on you, my friend, you're not going to get to heaven. But the Holy Spirit tugs on everybody's heart. At some point in time, you have had the opportunity. Everybody watching, you have had the opportunity to accept the Lord Jesus. You got another one today. I'm right here. I'm an opportunity today to teach you about the Lord Jesus Christ, to get your life right and meet Him and know Him. And you just somewhere be thankful. You know, we've talked so many times that at the heart of the gospel is having a thankful heart. Being thankful. Lord, I'm thankful that somebody cared. I'm thankful somebody talked to me. I'm thankful somebody, you know, told me about Jesus. I'm thankful. You know, sin fascinates, but then it assassinates. That's something you might want to write down somewhere, my friend, because sin does fascinate you, but it will assassinate you, and it's nothing to play around in. Sin's not your friend. Holiness is your friend. You know, every effort you've made, every decision to follow Jesus and to run far from sin will be rewarded when you get to heaven. There are rewards in heaven. You know, one of the things, I just put, wow, I just wrote everything all over my little, I just write, even after I do my notes and come back to them, I read them again, and I say, wow, 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 at the notes as I read them over, and I put wow all over this. And the grace of God is phenomenal. You will not be able to remember the times you failed when you get to heaven. You will not remember a failure. I'm talking about things that won't be there. You will not remember a failure. God says in Jeremiah 31:34, and they will not need to teach their neighbors, nor will they need to teach their relatives, saying, you should know the Lord. For everyone, from the least to the greatest, will know me already, says the Lord. And I will forgive their wickedness, and I will never again remember their sins. Glory to God. Look at Psalm 103. He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. East and west never meet. There's no sin in heaven, thank God. The very moment that if you go up in the rapture, or the moment that you leave this earth, that memory of that sin is gone and gone forever. That's shouting ground. Amen. Because though I don't know about you, because hell is always flashing something across my mind. Maybe I'm different than you. I got a lot he could flash. I thank God that the blood of Jesus has removed it. And I catch myself saying, oh, Lord, please forgive me. And I, oh, Lord, you've already forgiven me. You know, does anybody else go through that?
Yes.
Because hell loves to flash something across your mind. Helps to try to make you think you're still there. You're still that person, or that thing is not gone out of your life. Oh, yes, it is. Hallelujah. Yes. It's time to shout. Yes. There will not even be a memory. Look at your neighbor and say, no memory.
No memory.
Of bad things. Oh, glory to God. Sin has lost its grip. Number two, there will be hundreds of thousands there, but the many will not be there. Look at Matthew 7:13. You can enter God's kingdom only through the narrow gate. The highway to hell is broad, and its gate is wide for the many who choose that way. That many will not be there. That's a little frightening. Matthew 7:22. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and performed many miracles in your name. The beginning of it, on judgment day, many. That many will not be there. My friend, it's a fallacy, it's a lie when the world says, when someone, you know, that just because someone dies, that automatically they've gone to heaven. That's a lie. That's a bold-faced lie. A recent survey that was taken said that 94% of all Americans think that if they live good lives, they'll go to heaven. Did you hear me? 94%, that's a recent survey. That's a lie. That's misleading. That's deception. No, good works do not get you into heaven. You can be as good as you want to do. You can take care of this, take care of that, give money here, do this, do that, and the other. But if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, you will not go to heaven. You will not. There is a place to shun. Hell. There is a place called hell. It is eternal. God brought back to us a vision he gave me in 1996 pertaining to linens. And I would see emaciated people lying on a bed on the Word, covered over with the Word, and their head laying on the Word. And then they would spring up as they released their faith, totally healed. It covers your entire bed. And you're going to release your faith because they've already been anointed with oil and prayed over. But you learn to release your faith. And as you release your faith, God intervened. It's just a way to release your faith. It is the Word of God Almighty and a vision of 24 years ago. The twins are 165, the full are 209, the queens are 220, and the kings are 236. You give them as a gift. Do anything you can to spread the gospel and get the Word in somebody's face. I love this. Jesus made this little comment, and I just love it. You must be heaven-born to be heaven-bound. Speaking with Nicodemus, he said in John 3:3, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. John 14:6. Jesus told him, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. There is no other path. I don't care what the philosophers say. I don't care what your preacher says. I don't care what anybody says. If they say that there's another way outside of Jesus, they are lying to you. It's deceptive. It is, behind it is demon powers trying to keep you from moving into the truth. Jesus is the door. There is no other door. There is not a side door. There's not another name under heaven and earth. Jesus and Jesus only. That's the only way. The Lord said to proclaim it. I'm doing my best, Jesus. He said to proclaim it. He said it was very, very important. He said declare it boldly, clearly, because eternal, this is exact words, eternity hangs in the balance for so many who are listening now. Because there is a hell to shun. Amen. And a heaven to gain. Number three, what will heaven look like? Well, every indication is that man was made in the very image of God. That's what the Bible says, likeness of God. So earth was patterned after the image and likeness of heaven. So heaven is not going to be that big of a jarring place for a lot of people when we go there. It's not going to shock you as much as you think it will. We know from Revelation that there are trees that are there and rivers and homes and streets that are there in heaven. And we know that everything in heaven praises the Lord. We know that already. We know there are animals there. Glory, I get asked that question all the time. We know there are animals there. John the Revelator told us that Jesus will return at the second coming on a white horse, and that the armies of heaven will accompany him. I guarantee if there's horses there, there's dogs there, there's cats there are animals there. God is the creator. Satan is the duplicator. Amen. But God is great. I guarantee you, man has not, earth does not have something that brings love and joy to you that God did not put here. Amen. And there's not anything on earth that brings love and joy that is not in heaven. Revelation 19, verse 11. Then I saw heaven opened, and a white horse was standing there. His rider was named Faithful and True, for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. Verse 14. The armies of heaven, dressed in the finest of pure white linen, followed him on white horses. That's us, church. Hallelujah. Now, I'm excited about riding with him. Hallelujah. Amen. Aren't you glad that you've got a white horse just like his? Yeah. Oh, glory to God. Your new home is there. You may think your life down here isn't that great, but if you're following Jesus and if you're a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, and if you're listening to him, obeying the word, I promise you that your mansion in heaven, you know, Jesus has the most wonderful sense of humor. I promise you that your mansion in heaven will make Buckingham Palace look like a mud hut. The whole point of that is there's nothing on this earth, no matter what you may think it is, Taj Mahal, I don't care what it is, there's nothing on earth. It's all faded. It's all faint. It all needs painting. It all needs help compared to heaven. Amen. That's the point. Now, our salvation is absolutely secure if you're born again. But the level of your reward, and that's what we've been talking about, that's what I've been carrying on about, reward, is dependent on how you walked with the Lord here on the earth. But then I want a reward. If God's given out rewards, I want one. Yes, if he's given out crowns, I want one. Yes, if he's making it so that I can live closer to him, I want to. And listen, let me remind you that your living down here is not about just here. How you and I are acting out on this stage, it matters. It's going to have a great deal to do with how things turn out in heaven. I mean, you and I are writing our book now about heaven. Immaturity will keep you back. It's like a child who doesn't know what they really could inherit. And if they really knew what the father had, if they really knew what mom and daddy had, if they really knew what they could inherit, they would live a little differently. But because they're so immature, they just think, well, I'm just going to get it anyway. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. It's about our eternal destiny, about what your place in heaven's going to look like. It's even going to matter where you live in heaven. It's determined here by me and you, not predetermined by God. It's us. Number four, what are we going to do then when we get there? Well, we're going to praise and sing. We know that. We're going to celebrate the love of God. We know that. And the goodness and the faithfulness of God. Yeah, we're going to love that. We're going to worship God. And you can think of the greatest experience you've ever had with God in worship in any of your times here on the earth. There's no way you could possibly even imagine what it would be like to be in heaven. You're going to be reunited with your loved ones. You knew them. That's true. Anybody you knew before that knew God. The great thing is, remember, your memory will be gone. And if there's some there that you thought are not there, that you thought should be there, that's going to be erased from you. But it'd be a reunion with those that know the Lord beyond anything that we can even think about. Look at number 27, 12, and 13. Then the Lord said to Moses, go up to this mountain of Abarim and see the land which I have given to the sons of Israel. When you have seen it, you too will be gathered to your people as Aaron your brother was. Now I want you to see, it's not just about going to heaven to see Jesus. God told Moses, no, you're going to be gathered to your people, to your family, to your loved ones. You're going to be with your people and your loved ones. Look at Genesis 25:8. Abraham breathed his last and died in a ripe old age, an old man and satisfied with life, and he was gathered to his people. Look at Genesis 35:29. Isaac breathed his last and died and was gathered to his people, an old man of ripe age, and his sons Esau and Jacob buried him. Genesis 49:33. When Jacob finished charging his sons, he drew his feet into the bed, breathed his last, and was gathered to his people. Now, you are going to be reunited with your loved ones. So don't doubt that. Have no doubt about it. You're going to be reunited with them. And your relationship's going to be better than anything you could possibly ever imagine. In heaven, you're going to be, as I've said, absolutely satisfied. I mean, there will be no provision. There's nothing that you would ever want that heaven will not provide for you. Nothing. You're going to be happy in heaven, I promise you. It's a place of activity. Yes, there'll be a place of rest, but we're not talking about laziness now. And let me remind you, you've got the whole universe to govern, to be a part of. There are jobs in heaven. There are schools in heaven. There are businesses in heaven, creativity in heaven like you've never before seen. I mean, earth, you're a marvel at heaven. And everything you love here will be given to you, or you will be dealing with everything you love, but to a higher and greater extent. Amen. Everything on earth, even at its best, is not good compared to heaven. Amen. Heaven. See, it's just not real to us. Heaven. Look at what John saw in Revelation 7. That is why they stand in front of God's throne and serve him day and night in his temple, and he who sits on the throne will give them shelter. You're going to have fellowship with the saints. Look at Matthew 8:11. And I tell you this, that many Gentiles will come from all over the world, from east and west, and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob at the feast of the kingdom in heaven. Do you realize that at any point you want to, you can go have a conversation with Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob? You can go talk to David. You can talk to Esther. You can talk to anybody you want to talk to. You may live on the same streets with them. They may be your next door neighbor. Glory to God. Stephen, Peter, Paul, can you just imagine? You have perfect peace, perfect joy, perfect love. No more doubt. Never doubt the love of the Father. Never doubt the love of Jesus anymore. Never be sad. Never be depressed. Never be uneasy. Never be lonely. Never be discouraged. Perfect peace, perfect joy. My goodness. We cannot, it is so far removed, so close by, we just act like it's not really real. Number five, heaven has no expiration date. It's eternal. Now let me remind you, there is an appointed time for man. The Bible talks about there's appointed unto man to die once. We've been staring at people's appointed time showing up. Some of us got some appointed times. The expiration date's almost up. Everything and everybody has an expiration date on earth. Everything. But heaven is forever. Everything that's good is going to be there, and everything that's evil will not be there. Paul said in Philippians 1:23, I'm torn between two desires. I long to go and be with Christ, which is far better, he says, for me. Far better. Much, much better. It's better that I go and live with Christ. But because of you, and if I might can help you, I will stay here longer. He knew where he was going. Do you? Do you know there's a place you're going? That you're called to, being wooed to, every day of your life being wooed to, every day from heaven being wooed. Heaven's waiting on us. Heaven's more than a place. Heaven is a person. Jesus is the crowning glory of heaven. Amen. Let me go back to John 14, 2 through 3. There's more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything's ready, I'm going to come and get you so that you'll always be with me where I am. Yes, it's beautiful. Yes, we're going to enjoy it. Yes, you're going to be reunited with loved ones. But the greatest thing about heaven is that we will be where Jesus is. We will forever be with him.
Yes.
Forever. Forever be with him.
Yes.
So how ready are we? Father God, we thank you and bless you and praise you. Lord God, you're so good to us. We give you glory and we give you praise.